And happy Sabbath. I want to welcome you all to the Worthington Seventh-day Adventist Church. Whether you are worshiping here in person with us or online, we are glad to have you here. Psalms 95, 1-2 says, "Oh, come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us make a joyful noise to the rock of our salvation. Let us come into his presence with thanksgiving. Let us make a joyful noise to him with songs of praise." I now invite you all to stand and make a joyful noise to our Lord as we sing, "Oh, come to the altar."
Are you hurting and broken within? Overwhelmed by the weight of your sin? Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling.
Christ is risen.
may be seated. When we look back on our week, month, or even year, it's very easy to think of all the bad things that have happened. This year especially, it can be easy to forget that even through the bad, God is with us. In Romans 8:31, it says, "What then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us?" I want you to remember those words as we sing our next song. God is for us. But for me, this week was very exhausting. All I could focus on was how I had another test or more assignments, and I lost sight of all the blessings that God gave us. When I listened to this next song, I heard the words, "It's your breath in our lungs." Those words really reminded me that God created everything. He created the beautiful trees we get to see, the wonderful people here, and He created us. He is so great. And so I want to challenge you all today as we sing this next song, to remember how great He is.
You give life, You are love, You bring every heart that
now time for our opening prayer. Please kneel as far as possible. Dear God, we come before you today to praise and honor you. You are truly great. We want to thank you for bringing us through another week that we can all be here to worship you on this beautiful Sabbath morning. Whether we are worshiping here in person or at home, we ask that your presence be with us today. We especially ask that you be with Pastor Yulian as he shares his message with us. Father, I know there are people here before you with burdens on their heart, and I want to pray a special prayer for them that you let them be at peace. Let everything we do honor your name. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Good morning. Happy Sabbath to you. It's beautiful outside. Let's all stand for our opening hymn, Come Christian, Join to Sing. Everyone with us. Everyone with me.
Come Christian, join to sing. Alleluia, amen. Loud praise to Christ our King. Alleluia, amen. Let all with heart rejoice. Before his throne rejoice. Praise is his precious choice. Alleluia, amen.
Second stanza.
Come lift your hearts on high. Alleluia, amen. Let praises fill the sky. Alleluia, amen. He is our guide and friend. To us he'll condescend. His love shall never end.
Stands, sing with me now.
Praise ye our Christ again. Alleluia, amen. Life shall not end the strain. Alleluia, amen.
Sing it out.
O'er heaven's blissful shore, his goodness we'll adore.
Thank you. Be seated.
Most people learn about tithing at church before baptism. Well, I learned it through a tree. Yep, an orange tree. I was very young, but I can remember very well. My father was a Seventh-day Adventist pastor in Luau, Angola. We had 10 orange trees around our house. My brothers and I were allowed to eat from 9 of them, but the 10th tree was set apart for a special reason. It produced our tithe. We were not allowed to eat from that tree, nor even touch it.
Today, as a pastor, I feel blessed by my father's faithful life. It was at home, not at the church, that I learned to respect God and tithe. This was crucial. He brought to our house the lesson taught in the Garden of Eden, the chance to recognize God's authority and ownership, not only over our garden here on earth, but over our lives.
Commenting about Solomon's suggestion to honor the Lord with your possessions and with the first fruits of all your increase and the resulting blessings, Ellen G. White says, "This scripture teaches that God, as the giver of all our benefits, has a claim upon them, that his claim should be our first consideration, and that a special blessing would attend all who honor this claim." As you return your tithe and give your promise, take a moment to recognize his authority, goodness, and care. May we put our desires last and God first.
Last time I was up here, we clapped for the offering, so let's do that again, because we want to give God praises in everything. In Malachi chapter 1, verse 10, it says, bring the whole tithe into the storehouse so that there may be food on your table. I know that we're in some tough times, and some of us may not have food on our table, but God asks us to put him first. And if we do that, his promises are sure. And he will put food on your table in ways that you cannot even imagine. Let us pray. Our Father, which art in heaven, Lord, we thank you for this beautiful, sunshiny Sabbath day. We thank you for the gifts that you've given us. And Lord, as we return our tithes and offerings to you, we ask that they will go far in finishing the work so that you can come and take us home again. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
You probably noticed that the sun is quickly setting on summer, but good news, summer fun does not have to come to an end. This year, due to our unique situation, Worthington Seventh-day Adventist Church is able to invite not just our school and our daycare to participate in Week of Prayer, but you, our family, friends, and neighbors as well. If you register for our Week of Prayer to Mystery Island, you'll receive a bag that's going to have all kinds of cool stuff in it. This program is designed for children ages 0 to 12 and will be so much fun. Here's a little sample of what you'll get to do. You'll get to go on your own treasure hunt.
will be mine, Captain Crunch.
It will be mine, Captain Crispy.
You'll get to make your own octopus.
And our animal pal will help us remember how almighty God is. Today's animal pal is Flip the Flapjack Octopus.
God is the ruler. He's in charge. He's the king over everything. Wow.
And you'll also have the opportunity to win some cool prizes. Week of Prayer is always a highlight here on our campus because it's an opportunity for us to set aside extra time to learn about Jesus. And in this case, we're setting aside Bible, art, and science to devote more time to learning about him. Each day there will be a drama, songs, and even snacks for you to enjoy. And like I said before, this is open to not just our school and daycare, but to our friends, family, and neighbors as well. A $10 donation to Walk Ministries is greatly appreciated to help us cover the cost of all supplies. Week of Prayer is going to be held October 26th through the 30th. The deadline for registering will be October 16th, so please make sure you've contacted me by that time so I can make sure and have all the supplies that you'll need. These activities and so much more will be included in Week of Prayer. But best of all, the gift of learning about Jesus Christ. That is the best treasure of all.
All right, today's the 17th. Yesterday was the deadline, but God's grace is still available if you would like to sign up. Week of Prayer is going to begin on October 26th, but due to the hybrid situation that everyone is in this year, the materials are going to be available for several weeks, so you can complete it at your own pace during family worship, Sabbath afternoons, or whatever the case may be. But I do need to know by today if you would like any of those supplies so that we can make sure and have them all ready for you. Today I want to tell you a story about Farmer Finn. Farmer Finn was a very happy, happy guy, and so Dr. Harriet was delighted to go and meet with someone who was actually happy. Farmer Finn had a great big belly, and he always had a song in his heart. Generally, he was whistling. So Dr. Harriet went out to Farmer Finn's house one day because he was complaining that six of his calves were acting really strange. And sure enough, when he got out, he discovered that they were acting very, very strange. They were walking around and fumbling. And at one point, he even saw one of the calves go right up to the cement block wall and stand with his nose right up against the wall. It was weird. Farmer Finn was right, but not even this situation could get him down. He still had a little pep in his step. Well, what are you going to do for him, Dr. Harriet? Something new, something fancy, he thought. Dr. Harriet started with his thermometer, not very new, not very fancy. But it gave him a little bit of time to think. And as he looked around in the very dark, dark barn, remember this is the 1930s, so you don't just flip on a switch, looked around in the dark, dark barn, and suddenly things started to come together for him. It must be lead poisoning. So he told Farmer Finn that, and Farmer Finn said what all farmers say. Well, I've had calves in this barn for 30 years. Never had a problem like that before. Well, closer examination, Dr. Harriet discovered that there was a hole in the barn, and Farmer Finn had patched the hole with a piece of wood that had lead paint on it. And calves, just like small children, love to find the weakest parts of the wall and pick, 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 and suck, suck, suck. And certainly there were teeth marks on that board. That board was what the lead paint was on. And sure enough, it was giving them lead poisoning. Now, 1930s, there weren't specific antidotes that you could give. There weren't fancy shots. Your best chance was to give your cattle just Epsom salts, which has some very undesirable side effects, especially given in large quantities. But that was their best shot, so Dr. Harriet told Farmer Finn that that's what he should do. And sure enough, after taking those Epsom salts and getting the undesirable side effects, after several days, those calves turned right around. It was amazing. Well, a couple weeks later, Dr. Harriet got another call out to Farmer Finn's house. This time, he needed him to come out because his prize bull, his shorthorn, his big show winner, was acting very strangely, breathing hard, and acting like he was on death's door. So Dr. Harriet went out and he took a look. He took his temperature. Now, the average temperature for a cow is 100 to 102 degrees. Did you know that? 100 to 102? This cow's temperature was 110. So Dr. Harriet said, "Have you had this cow out today?" Sure enough, that cow had been out in the sun and he had gotten overheated. So Dr. Harriet called for some water and they sprayed that cow down, and that's what saved his life. Now, a few weeks later, there was a big meeting of the farmers, and they were all sitting around and listening to a veterinarian who was saying, "Your animals are going to be treated like human patients soon. Oh, there's fancy medications, and there's fancy pills, and all kinds of things that we can do for your animals now." And Farmer Finn just couldn't take it anymore. He said, "What? The guy I've had out most recently, just out of vet school, he comes out, and all he uses is Epsom salts and water." Simple things can fix a lot of problems, can't they? It's about that time of year where we're going to start eating a lot of fancy foods, and there's going to be a lot of people who might be seeking some weight loss pills or some other such things, problems that could be avoided with just simple little fixes. New start. You know the information: nutrition, exercise, say it with me, water, sunshine, temperance, 2 donuts instead of 25, fresh air, rest, and most importantly, trust in God. Simple little things can help us avoid big problems. And a lot of things could be avoided. A lot of the big fancy medications and treatments and pills and potions and all kinds of things wouldn't even be needed if we just did the simple stuff first. You need some self-control during this time of the year? Yes, raise your hands. You need some self-control. We're looking at candy time and cookie time coming up. So let's pray for that now. Jesus, thanks so much for your love and for your watch care over us. Forgive us for the times when we have not done the simple things to keep ourselves healthy and well. Help us to remember to have self-control during this time of year and to use the tools that you've given us so that we can feel and stay healthy and well. In Jesus' name, we all said together, amen.
You guys just give me a nod when you're ready to start. At Calvary, I know my Lord expects the best from me. How many are the lost that I have lifted? How many are the chained I've helped to free? I wonder, have I done my best for Jesus when he has done so much for me? Many are the laws that I have lifted. Jesus, when he has done so much for me. I wonder, have I cared enough for others, or have I let them die alone? I might have helped to wander to the Savior, the seed of precious life I might have sown. Oh, many are the lost that I have lifted. How many are the chained I've helped to free? I wonder, have I done my best for Jesus when he has done so much for me? No longer stay within the valley, I'll climb the mountain heights above. The world is dying now, what of someone to tell them of the Savior's matchless love? How many are the lost that I have?
Good morning, church family.
Good morning.
And thank you very much, Noah, for helping. I would like to give a special round of applause to Faith Davis. So Faith, would you please stand up and turn toward the congregation? She did an amazing job. This was her first time leading and transitioning the worship service. Thank you. That was really good. And BJ and Lovely, where did you go? You disappeared on me. Oh, you're in the back. Thank you so much. And Roger, he's somewhere here. Thank you also, Roger, for accompanying. Thank you very much, Grace Notes. And thank you, people of God, for being here today. For those of you who are new with us, we are right in the middle of the Gospel of John. And before we continue with the topic today, I would like to invite the people upstairs to dim the lights, let's see our bumper video, and let's tune up heaven words so that we can hear the divine word of God.
Thank you.
Would you please bow your heads with me and let's invite the divine presence to bless his word. Heavenly Father, we are pausing for a minute to claim one of your greatest promises, that your word is never going to return empty. And I would like to ask you to bless each one of us here as we are pausing for a minute to empty our hearts of all the burdens of life and to lay them in front of your throne of grace and to ask you to bless your word so that we can hear your voice, to bless also our hearts so that they'll be receptive to the truth that you're going to share with us. We humbly ask for your presence only in the name of Jesus. And all the people of God said together, amen. For 1,500 years, Israel was waiting for her knight in shining armor to arrive. And when he finally came, the tragedy was that Israel didn't recognize him. The question is, what happened? How in the world the people of God who warmed the pews of their synagogues every single Sabbath, who prayed thousands of prayers throughout their lives, who celebrated so many Passovers, anticipating the coming of their prince, of their knight in shining armor, when he arrived, the majority of the people of Israel didn't recognize him. And the question is, can this happen to us too? Can he also appear in our midst and we miss his presence? As a matter of fact, I do believe it is possible. I do believe the reason why half of the Gospel of John is devoted to the last week of Jesus' life, and every single sermon from now on, as we are going to consider, you're going to see that the Bible puts the spotlight on a particular response of the people of God to the presence of Jesus. And I bet if you and I are paying attention to what the Word of God is going to say, you're going to see yourself, I'm going to see myself, somewhere in the story of Israel. So I titled my message today, Save Us Now. And you're going to see in just a few minutes why I chose this title. I would like to invite you to open your Bibles with me to the Gospel of John. Today we're going to spend our time in a few verses in chapter 12, but I would like us to read for the matter of context one verse from chapter 11, and I know that the two Lauras, Laura Hacks and Laura Kamik, they volunteered to speak for me and to read the scriptures for me. So Laura Hacks is ready. Laura, would you please read verse 55 of chapter 11 and then jump to verse 9 through 13.
When it was almost time for the Jewish Passover, many went up from the country to Jerusalem for their ceremonial cleansing before Passover. Meanwhile, a large crowd of Jews found out that Jesus was there and came, not only because of him, but also to see Lazarus, whom he had raised from the dead. So the chief priests made plans to kill Lazarus as well. For on account of him, many of the Jews were going over to Jesus and putting their faith in him. The next day, the great crowd that had come for the feast heard that Jesus was on his way to Jerusalem. They took palm branches and went out to meet him, shouting, Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the King of Israel.
Thank you, Laura. It was Passover time. It was a special time for Israel. This was Israel's 4th of July. This was Independence Day. And while the Israelites were marching toward Jerusalem to worship God, while they were about to celebrate their independence, they couldn't shake this strange feeling that something is wrong with their celebration. Because as they were celebrating their Independence Day in AD 31, this was the 94th anniversary of their enslavement under the Iron Fist of Rome. The Jewish people were fiercely independent, and they were known for insurrection and attempts to overthrow and cast out their foreign rulers. So that particular Passover was no different, and yet, in some respect, it was. The atmosphere on that Passover was white hot, with tension and explosiveness. Not long ago, Jesus had resurrected a decaying corpse. And this time, the people were coming to Jerusalem by droves, not only to celebrate their Independence Day, but in order to see the one who might actually offer a real Independence Day for the people of Israel. Because you see, people wanted to see Jesus. He was charismatic. He had everything that a leader of Israel needed to have. He was charismatic. He was well composed, powerful in speech and in action. If the armies of Israel ever run out of food, he can miraculously supply them with food anywhere. If one of their soldiers gets wounded, he can heal the wound instantaneously. And even if some of them were to get killed, he can resurrect them and keep them marching on until they have stunned the last enemy of the people of Israel. What army, they thought, could stand against such king? Yet not everybody actually liked Jesus. Well, yes, there were people who were cheering for him and expecting him to take the rulership. There were others who hated him from the bottom of their guts. Caiaphas and the leaders of the Sanhedrin had their hit list, and Jesus was on the top. And now, according to what we just read, they have included also Lazarus, because he had the audacity to listen to the voice of Jesus and get out of the tomb. So the situation in Jerusalem was explosive. And then suddenly, verse 13 tells us, suddenly the crowd exploded with thousands upon thousands and ten thousands of hosannas. You see, oftentimes we read the Bible and we read these hallelujahs and hosannas and we think that they are just expressions of worship. And yet, for the people of Israel, this meant a lot. You see, Hosanna, Hoshiana, as it's pronounced in Hebrew, is actually a plea. And it literally means, save us now! Historian Josephus tells us that on Passover, between 1.5 and 2.5 million people were present in Jerusalem. And can you imagine tens of thousands and probably hundreds of thousands of people picking up this Hosanna and shouting, save us now, save us now, become our savior, become our leader, become our king. And suddenly, tens of thousands and hundreds of thousands started chanting Psalm 118 verses 25 and 26, which for us are just a scripture, but for the people of Israel at that time was a national anthem, a plea for Messiah to act and set them free. And the song was picked up by voices all over the hills surrounding Jerusalem. And suddenly you see some Israelites putting their MEGA baseball caps, make Israel great again. And they chant and they sing. And the atmosphere is filled with fire of rebellion and desire for freedom. As a matter of fact, Psalm 118 has not been sung with such enthusiasm for the last 173 years, since the time of Simon the Maccabee, who set Jerusalem free from the Syrian oppression and rode on a mighty stallion into Jerusalem as people were waving palm branches. As a matter of fact, the very presence of palm branches is also a symbol of their political aspirations for independence from the Romans. Because palm branches were not only used during the victory of Simon the Maccabee. Maccabee means the hammer, who smashed the oppression of the Syrians. And now they were waving their branches and wearing proudly their MEGA baseball caps and pleading Jesus to march victorious into the city, seize the power, and call the people of Israel to arms. What was the reaction of Jesus? Let's read verses 14 and 15. So, Laura Kamik, if you don't mind.
Jesus found a young donkey and sat on it. And as it is written, "Do not be afraid, daughter Zion. See, your king is coming, seated on a donkey colt."
Huh. How did the king of the universe appear to his waiting people? Did he appear in triumphant chariot? Or maybe he was riding on a mighty prancing stallion as he was entering Jerusalem? Did he? What Jesus did ruined the whole image. As the people of Israel were waving their palm branches and shouting their hosannas, they were reminiscing the victory of Simon the Maccabee. And they were envisioning that someone greater than him is here. And instead of riding on a white prancing stallion, Jesus is riding on what? On what? What kind of donkey? Young donkey. Actually, the Greek is very specific. We don't have in English a diminutive form. We should say little donkey. This does not sound the same. In Greek says, like we say dog and doggy, so donkey, little one. Probably the feet of Jesus were dragging on the dust of Palestine as he was majestically riding his donkey. So friends, let's face it. Donkeys are not impressive animals. You don't go to war riding a donkey unless you want to kill your enemies with humor, because they're going to fall off their horses when they see you appearing, leading the armies of Israel, riding on a donkey and dragging your feet in the dust of Palestine. And I would like to ask you, have you ever expected God, your knight in shining armor to appear in your life, riding victoriously on a mighty stallion. Only to see him riding a ridiculous donkey and coming late. 173 years late. I would like to tell you something about Jesus, if you have not figured it out yet. Jesus paints from a different palette than the people of Israel. And I would like to tell you that he paints your life from a different palette than you yourself would. And this is one of the most strange and sometimes discouraging things about Jesus. We too, like Israel, would like a Jesus riding on a mighty steed, coming into our lives victorious, healing all of our diseases, filling our bank accounts and making our businesses prosperous. We always would like to have a Jesus riding on a stallion, coming to heal us, coming to save us, coming to bring to us the prince or the princess of our lives, only to discover that many times he rides on a donkey, a little donkey. Many men and women do not have the capability to recognize the presence of God in their lives because oftentimes they miss his presence. We are so conditioned to grandioseness of our lives, to all these things that we have seen on TV, to all the things that movie stars portray to us, that we miss the presence of God. Because oftentimes, God comes in our lives in the garb of tattered poverty and unassuming circumstances. Many of us, like Israel, have turned our backs on Jesus because he did not come to us the way we expected him to come. In verse 15, John says, "Your king is coming, sitting on a donkey's colt." He's actually quoting Zacharias. And I would like to explain why will Jesus come to his people, his oppressed people, his enslaved people, who have not enjoyed freedom for 173 years. Why will he come to them on a donkey when they expect him to come as a king? And then John tells us that he and the disciples didn't understand either. They were disappointed with Jesus. Have you ever been disappointed with Jesus? Anyone here? The disciples were disappointed with Jesus. And they didn't understand why will he come on a donkey. But later they understood. And this is John putting this reference to Zechariah chapter 9. And here is what Zechariah actually says. He puts just the first line, but he wants us to go back and read this messianic passage. Here is what it says. "Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout, O daughter of Jerusalem. Behold, your king is coming to you. He is just and he has salvation. And he is what? He is majestic. He is proud. No, he is lowly. And he is riding on a donkey, a colt, the foal of a donkey." And then he says, God says, "I will cut off the chariot from Ephraim and the horse from Jerusalem. The battle bow shall be cut off, and he," this is the Messiah, "shall speak peace only to Israel." Is this what the Bible says? To whom? To the nations. Actually, the Hebrew word means to all the nations, to all these people who are not Israelites. There is a specific word that the Hebrew Bible uses for the people of God. They are Am in Hebrew. But the nations, the people who are not people of God, they are Goyim. And here the word Goyim is used. Jesus was coming with a much greater mission to his people than what they were expecting him to do. He was coming to be the king of peace for all nations, not to favor one nation. He was coming to set not just one nation free, he was coming to set all nations free. And it meant that Jesus is not going to answer the fervent prayer of Israel, save us now. He is not going to honor the sign on their baseball caps, MIGA, make Israel great again. Not now. Because there are other nations who need to hear about him and who need to be saved. And it was too much for Israel to swallow this inconvenient truth. Yet the time is going to come when the book of Revelation tells us that Jesus is going to come on a white horse. He's going to come like the prince in the shining armor, but not now. Here is what the book of Revelation tells us. Now I saw heaven opened, and behold, what animal? White horse. And he who sat on him was called faithful and true, and in righteousness he judges, and he does what? He wages war, because a horse is an animal of war. And the armies, what? Armies in heaven, clothed in fine linen, white and clean, followed him on white horses. The time is going to come when he's going to appear as a warrior. But first, in his very first coming, Jesus appeared as a humble savior to all the nations, to the whole world. And I would like to show you something that actually John changes in the text that he is quoting. He is quoting this text. He is quoting the first few lines of this text up to here. But he replaces this phrase. In the Bible, in the Old Testament, in Zechariah, it says, rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. What does John say? Fear not. Remember, John writes 25 years after the Temple of Jerusalem is destroyed, after the people of God are dispersed to all the nations, and they have lost their national identity, their temple, Jerusalem. Just a few years later, after John wrote his gospel, they're going to be forbidden to come to Jerusalem. Even the name of Jerusalem is going to be changed from Jerusalem to Arena Capitolina. And Jews are going to be forbidden to enter Jerusalem. So John says, fear not. I know it looks to you that because Jesus didn't come on a majestic stallion, everything is lost. I know sometimes you fear and you're praying to God and God is not coming to you in majesty as you expect him. Instead, he is coming in a humble donkey. And you think everything is lost. Everything is going to go south. And John tells us, by inspiration, fear not. God is still in control. For those who love God, all things work together for good. Even the disappointments of life. Even the disappointments of life. Because if you are with God, nobody can be against you. Finally, let's read verses 16 through 19 to see the reaction of the disciples. We're going to see also a little bit of the reaction of the Pharisees, but I'm going to reserve this for another presentation in the future. So let's see now the reaction of the disciples. So anyone would like to read? Okay, Laura. Thank you, Laura.
At first, his disciples did not understand all this. Only after Jesus was glorified did they realize that these things had been written about him and that they had done these things to him. Now the crowd that was with him when he called Lazarus from the tomb and raised him from the dead continued to spread the word. Many people, because they had heard that he had given this miraculous sign, went out to meet him. So the Pharisees said to one another, "See, this is getting us nowhere. Look how the whole world has gone after him."
Mm-hmm. Thank you. I would like you to notice, besides that the disciples didn't know, they figured this later when the Holy Spirit was poured on them. I would like you to also pay attention to what they were doing right there in the moment when Jesus was riding his donkey. The people who were with him when he called Lazarus out of the tomb, the people who witnessed some of the miracles of Jesus, they were doing what? They bore witness. I would like you to pay attention to that. And let me for a minute try to picture what was happening there. When the pagan kings had a triumphant march into a city, they will parade all their trophies. They will parade the enslaved women and children and the heads, the beheaded heads of the generals of the armies that they defeated. This was the procession of a victorious king in the times when Jesus was walking the earth. Yet Jesus organizes a different procession. The trophies of his procession are not beheaded people and not enslaved people. The trophies of his procession are people that he himself has set free. Trophies that he has set free from leprosy, from physical maladies, from demon possession, and even called out of the grave. The trophies of his procession were people who have been given the tongue to praise God. And as they were walking there, the ex-mute people, they were praising the Lord the loudest. As the crippled were walking with Jesus, they were jumping the highest and they were running and cutting branches and laying them in front of his donkey because they were so thankful for what Jesus has done to them. And they were telling everybody, "This is what Jesus did for me." Those who have been lepers, they were laying on the ground, untamed garments. And those who have been called to life through the voice of Jesus were walking closely to him as trophies of life and salvation. And I would like to ask you, what has Jesus done for you? Has Jesus done anything in your life that is worth noticing? Do you have a story to tell? If you tell me, and I can hear some of you screaming to me, "I don't remember anything significant that I can tell," well, then God be merciful on you and open your eyes to see the story that you have to tell. Because as far as I'm concerned, you're still breathing. And every breath you take is a precious gift from God. As far as I'm concerned, your heart is still pumping, even though in the midst of disappointments and in the midst of unrealized dreams. But you still have something that you can praise God for. And I would like to ask you today, have you ever thought, what is my story? What do I have to give this world? Because I would like to tell you, for many people, you and I, we're going to be the only Bible that they'll ever crack open to read. What are they reading? What are your colleagues at work reading from you? What are your colleagues at school and your teachers and professors reading from you? Do you have a story to tell? And the question is, are you telling the story? In what ways has the humble Jesus touched your life? Israel was waiting impatiently for 1,500 years for her knight in shining armor to appear, to arrive in pomp and majesty, and to set her free. For her dismay, the knight appeared horseless and shrouded in the tattered garbs of poverty. This was enough for the powerful of the day to reject Jesus. And even though the powerless did not reject him right away and shouted ecstatically, "Hosanna," for a day, we don't hear anymore of these tens and hundreds of thousands of people cheering for Jesus. Because after this day, they went in their lodges, in their homes, and they forgot about Jesus. Because Jesus did not meet their expectations. Jesus broke their dreams. He did not come in their life as a knight in a shining armor. He came in the garb of a peasant from Galilee and not worth noticing. That day in which they were singing ecstatically hosannas and proudly wearing their meager cups didn't change anything in their hearts. Because Jesus disappointed them. And I would like to ask you again, has Jesus disappointed you? You've prayed for years for him to bring the prince or the princess in your life, and the answer does not come. You prayed for your health, and it seems that God is not listening much, or at least if he is, he's coming on a donkey. Are you disappointed with Jesus? The people of Israel were disappointed with the true Messiah because he came to set them free from sin, and they wanted to be set free from their enslavement. He didn't come to set them free from the Romans. Their dream was to be saved now. And Jesus was promising a salvation one day. And I would like to ask you, is it possible that sometimes our broken dreams and unrealized expectations stand in our way and we do not see Jesus when he is coming in our lives riding his humble donkey? I would like to read at the end of our sermon a Bible text from the book of Revelation. In the book of Revelation, we are told that one day there are going to be people standing and praising Jesus with waving palm branches. Listen to that. After these things, I looked, and behold, a great multitude which no one could number, of all nations, tribes, people, and tongues, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed with white robes, with palm branches in their hands, crying out with a loud voice, "Salvation belongs to our God. He has saved now. Hosanna. Hosanna to him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb." Then one of the elders asked me, "Who are these arrayed in white and waving the palm branches?" And I said, "I don't know, sir, you know." And then he answered, "These are the ones who came out of the great tribulation and washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Therefore, they are before the throne of God and serve him day and night in his temple. And he who sits on the throne will dwell forever among them. They shall neither hunger anymore, nor thirst anymore, nor the sun shall strike them any longer, for the Lamb who is in their midst will shepherd them and lead them to the fountains of living water." Well, I understand, and you probably understand, that the Great Tribulation referred here in the Revelation is to a specific event. I would like to tell you that there is going to be a great crowd in heaven waving the palm branches and singing Hosanna, because they have gone through their own tribulation here in this world, of disappointments, of sickness, of not receiving on time, Jesus dragging his feet on the ground of this earth, not receiving on time their answers to the prayers of health, not receiving their answers to the prayer of prosperity, not receiving their answers on time to the prayer of a future husband, a future child. But they're going to wave the branches one day, because they have learned that you can sing Hosanna and not expect all the answers to come right now, and still love God as you're waiting for him to come as your prince, as your knight in a shining armor. So today I would like to encourage you on behalf of God. Don't give up on him. Do not let the circumstances of your life blind you for his presence. Because oftentimes our Lord Jesus comes in our lives riding on a humble donkey in the tattered garbs of poverty and unanswered prayers. Do not discard his presence. Amen.
That old song, Lord, I want to be in that number when the saints go marching in. Amen. Thank you, Pastor, for that sermon. Let's all stand together for our closing hymn, Crown Him with Many Crowns. Everyone with me.
Crown him with many crowns, the Lamb upon his throne. Hark how the heavenly angel drowned all music but its own. Awake, my soul, and sing of him who died for thee. King through all eternity.
Ladies only, come on, ladies, sing it. Sing it out. Beautiful. Sing it out. In with me.
Crown him the Lord of peace, whose hand a scepter sways. From pole to pole the war may cease, and all be prayer and praise. His reign shall know no end. Fair flowers
bow our heads for our closing prayer. Heavenly Father, I would like to thank you for these tough lessons that you give us sometimes in Scripture, and yet you're honest with us and you do not sugarcoat the difficulties that life sometimes presents. Help us, Lord, to never lose sight of you, even though Satan is going to try his best in the middle of our pains and disappointments to hide your face from us. Help us to see your humble appearance in the little and big blessings that you bring to us day in and day out. I would like to ask you in particular for those who are going through very rough times in their lives, for those who are struggling with their health and they are asking you for healing, I would like to ask you, Lord, to be with them and to answer some of these prayers and to give them the assurance and the support that you are with them and that you will never gonna desert them. Heavenly Father, I would like to ask you also for us as your church. To each one of us, you have given a testimony, and help us, Lord, to not rob the world from this amazing gift that you have given each one of us. Help us, Lord, to tell the world the story of our salvation. Help us, Lord, to share with those in our workplace, in our homes, and in our universities and our schools what you have done for us and what amazing God and Savior you have been. Thank you, Lord, for listening to our prayers. We humbly ask for your answer in the name of Jesus, our Lord. And all the people of God said together, amen. Amen.